Let me know when you're ready.
Greetings, everyone. Welcome to the Black History Month extravaganza. We are honored that you have joined us today. We have a great journey planned for you. First, let's start off by acknowledging God, for without him, none of this would be possible. Please join us in prayer, which is led by Mr. Gonzalez.
Let us go ahead and begin as we do all things. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Merciful God, you bring freedom to those who have been oppressed and enslaved. You are the liberator of your people. May we be a people who reflect your character and advocate for the liberation of people who are pushed down by the systemic injustice and prejudice. We thank you this month for the leaders in our community and for the leaders of our past, like Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks, and Martin Luther King Jr. May we follow their lead and fight for freedom at every turn. May we know the weight of our responsibility and the levity of your grace. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Gonzalez, for your prayer. Our speaker for today is Darryl Locket. He is the executive director of the Kennedy King Memorial Initiative, a nonprofit organization dedicated to build on the historical event of April 4th, 1968, to raise awareness, provoke thought, and inspire action to eliminate division and injustice. Before joining KKMI, as its first full-time executive director in January 2020, Locket was the advisor to the president of AARP Foundation in Washington, D.C., focused upon tackling senior poverty and helping vulnerable older adults build economic opportunity and social connectedness. He developed and implemented the foundation's partnership-focused growth plan, managed external relations and strategic positioning, and bolstered the organization's effort in strategic grant making, innovation, and business operations. Please help me welcome Mr. Locket.
Thank you all so much. I'm so happy to be with you guys. Unfortunately, I'm not there in person, but I'm with you guys virtually. And I want to send a very much word of appreciation to Mr. Yakey, who has been a dear friend and brother of mine now for over 25 years. So I was just, overjoyed that, Providence Cristo Race saw fit to reach out. I've had a, opportunity to meet, your president, and, we've really grown close in these few months. But I was just delighted to share with you today on this Black History Month. So I want to go ahead and begin because, I know my time is short, but I have a lot that I want to share with you today. So as this is Black History Month, there is no American history without Black history. And we take time every February to commemorate that truth because there were heroes that we want to honor and recognize who have overcome and achieved excellence and triumph in the face of unconscionable discrimination. Now you're going to see throughout my presentation in the lower corner there are quotes from famous African-Americans that I want to call out to your attention. Carter G. Woodson is the father of Black History Month. He's the father of Black History Week that turned into Black History Month. But what he said was, what we need is not a history of selected races or nations, but the history of a world void of national bias, race, hate, or religious prejudice. And that's really what we're coming together trying to weave in the story of every person, every ethnic group, every religion into the story of America. But as we know, the Declaration of Independence stated that all men were created equal at a time when that only applied to white land-owning men. So during Black History Month, we celebrate the contributions of African Americans who have fought to make this country uphold its ideals. So then we sit back and say, why study history to begin with? And it's really three things that I want to focus on today as to why we should really dig in deep this Black History Month. One, to understand one's identity, and that's the self concept. Two, to develop an understanding of cultures and the community which we all live, and that's self-efficacy. And three, to become inspired. Marcus Garvey said it best. He said, a people without the knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots. So we're really talking about know thyself. The self concept is the collection of beliefs about oneself, and it answers the question, who am I? So when we get a better understanding of history, when we get a better understanding of the Africans' existence in America, that story didn't just begin with the slave ship. There were lives that were brought here. There were doctors, there were engineers, there were architects who were then enslaved. African-American history did not begin with a slave. It began with a theorist. It began with a religious leader who was forced into slavery. Self-efficacy is the belief that we have in our own abilities, specifically our ability to meet the challenges ahead of us and complete a task successfully. When we look back at some of those in the African-American community who have overcome great obstacles, we realize that we are equipped ourselves as individuals, as a collective group, to do just that and even more. And the last point is self-actualization. That is the complete realization of one's potential and the full development of one's ability and appreciation for life. That's the goal that each one of your teachers and each one of your administrators has for you, that you truly realize all of what God has deposited within you and to bring it life for the benefit of someone else. You know, there's a picture over to the side of this slide. Does anyone know what that's a picture from? I can't hear anybody. Just yell out if you feel it. Anybody know what that's from? Teachers too. That's a photo from the Kenneth and Mamie Clark doll test of 1947. And that was used as some of the underlying influence to overturn the segregation of schools in the Brown versus Board of Education case. Because this student, a young African-American boy, is expressing there that he has a preference for a white doll more than he does a doll that looks like him. And it gets to a quote by Susan Taylor that whatever we believe about ourselves and our ability comes true for us. There's another quote that says, the man who believes he can and the man who believes he can't are both right. So when you think about this, I want you to think back about history. Think back about those greats that you know who have overcome barriers and obstacles and say, that's me too. That's my circumstance. That's my situation. Yes, I might have not been born with a silver spoon in my mouth. Yes, I might have had to struggle. Yes, I might have had to work an extra job. Yes, my parents may or may not have been at every game or every activity, but I'm equipped with a community. I'm equipped with the spirit. I'm equipped with the belief in myself that I could accomplish anything and more. So oftentimes we hear people say nowadays, this is for the culture. You're doing it for the culture. But what exactly does that mean? And I know you guys are delving deep into this, but culture is truly the characteristics and knowledge of a particular group of people, encompassing language, religion, traditions, institutions, cuisine, social habits, arts, and achievement. African-American culture refers to the contributions of African-Americans to the culture of the United States, either as a part of or distinct from mainstream American culture. So the question I ask you today, what can you do to advance the culture? Now, some of you may say, I want to be a basketball player. Okay, well, how can you advance the culture through basketball? Some of you may want to be a lawyer. How can I advance the culture through the law? Some of you may just want to own your own business. How can I advance the culture through that? Whether that be supporting institutions, whether that be building upon the arts, building upon traditions, or just keeping those things alive in your daily existence. Because Bob Marley, the famous musician, said the greatness of a man is not in how much wealth he acquires, but in his integrity and his ability to affect those around him positively. So I want to do a quick exercise, and I'm going to show you a person from the past and show you how embracing history and the knowledge of history and self can open doors for the future. This first person here, does anyone know who that is? That's Dr. Daniel Hale Williams, the first individual of any race to perform open heart surgery. And who do we see here? We see Dr. Kizzmekia Corbett, who is the lead researcher in finding a vaccine for the COVID-19 virus. We have Sidney Poitier, the first African-American man to win an Oscar Academy Award. And who do we have? Inspired by his greatness, Chadwick Boseman, that we know of as the Black Panther. We have Bessie Coleman, the first African-American man or woman to become a licensed pilot. And we have Madeline Swiegel, the first African-American woman to become a Navy fighter pilot in 2020. We have Althea Gibson, the first woman, African-American woman, to win at the Wimbledon. And of course, as you all know, Serena Williams, who is going down in history as the greatest tennis player of all time. We have Phyllis Wheatley, the first African-American to publish a book of poetry in 1733. And we have Amanda Gorman, the youngest poet laureate who spoke at the inauguration of President Joe Biden. We have Shirley Chisholm, the first African-American woman elected to Congress and the first woman to run as a nominee for the nomination for president. And of course, we have our near dear Vice President of the United States, Kamala Harris. So we talk about Black excellence and we hear that thrown around all the time, but excellence while overcoming adversity. I want you all to take these 6 points here and realize that excellence can be obtained for each and every one of you. The first thing you have to do is decide to be the best, not just anybody. You have to decide to be the best. Serena Williams didn't start out and say, I just want to be, you know, a decent tennis player. She said, I want to be the best. And by doing so, you set the highest standard for yourself, not accepting mediocrity, realizing that you are equipped, going back to the self-efficacy, to achieve on the highest standards. Have a broad vision for yourself, not just Indianapolis, but what impact do you want to have on the entire world? How do you want to advance the culture? And these three right here are probably the most difficult. To take the initiative, to get out there and do it. When you see something that hasn't been done, let that motivate you to be the first to do it, to engage in sustained effort, and to remain determined. Booker T. Washington, noted as one of the greatest African-American leaders this country has ever seen, said, success is to be measured not so much by the position that one has reached in life, as by the obstacles which he has overcome. And I can only speak for myself. I know that I've had personal obstacles that I've had to overcome. And I think that each of you can think back long and hard of obstacles that you may be dealing with now, but trust, engaging in sustained effort and remaining determined, you too can be excellent. An example of Black excellence, Garrett A. Morgan. Garrett A. Morgan was an inventor and a businessman known for inventing the gas mask and the traffic signal. And he used that gas mask in 1916 to rescue three people from a tunnel 50 feet below Lake Erie. He is also credited as being one of the first African Americans in America to own an automobile. But what did he say? If you can be the best, then why not try to be the best? Mae Jemison, another example of Black excellence, is an American engineer, physician, and former astronaut, but she became the first Black woman to travel in space in 1987 aboard Space Shuttle Endeavour. She spent 12 days and orbited around Earth and the globe. But she says, never limit yourself because of others' limited imagination. Never limit others because of your own limited imagination. And those get back to those earlier points. And as you guys know very well, Wilton Daniel Gregory is an American prelate of the Catholic Church who's the Archbishop of Washington. But in 2020, Pope Francis elevated him to the rank of cardinal, making him the first African-American cardinal. But he said this, the enduring legacy is the horizon of possibilities that exist for this nation to live out the fulfillment of its lofty heritage of equality and the unfettered human potential that was restricted to only one segment of society when he first began the struggle for freedom. So Black excellence is not solely attributed to those extraordinary individuals, athletes, poets, artists who have reached celebrity status. Black excellence happens every day. I hope some of you see yourselves in that. Hope some of you see yourselves in these pictures that are reflected here, because you too have all that's within you to be excellent. And I want to leave with just a few excerpts of this wonderful poem by Maya Angelou called Still I Rise. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still like dust, I'll rise. Just like moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides, just like hopes springing high, still I rise. And thinking about the journey that we've gone through and the journey that African Americans have gone through for equality, acceptance, and inclusion in America, listen to these words. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, Providence Cristo Rey, I rise. Thank you so much for having me. I hope you have taken just something from this time and apply it to your life and just, you know, continue to grow and realize that you too have excellence within you.
Motivational message. Those are truly words that we can all apply to our life. Now we're going to shift gears a little bit. I want to take you on a journey. On this spiritual journey, you will discover how music, dance, literature, art, and food help to preserve and create the culture of the Black people in America. Up first, you will see a performance called Respect. First, we're going to have the Corinthian song by Miss Valerie Vincent.
Delivered me.
Coming up next, you will see a skit entitled Encourage Yourself, and you will also hear a song entitled Almost Is Never Enough.
To say we gave it a try, I like to blame it all on life. Maybe we just weren't right, but that's a lie, and that's a lie. And we can deny it as much as you want, but in time our feelings will show. Because sooner or later we'll wonder why we gave up. The truth is everyone knows. Almost is never enough.
Experience the color of black art.
Hey, black child, do you know who you are, who you really are? Do you know you can be what you want to be? If you try to be what you can be. Hey, black child, do you know where you're going, where you're really going? Do you know you can learn what you want to learn? If you try to learn what you can learn. Hey, black child, do you know you are strong? I mean, really strong. Do you know you can do what you want to do? If you try to do what you can do. Hey, black child, be what you can be. Learn what you must learn. Do what you can do. And tomorrow, your nation will be what you want it to be.
Black artists have shared exquisite portrayals of struggles and triumphs of African Americans through their paintings, sculptures, and other artwork. Here are some famous Black artists that they did. Augustus Savage, Carl Walker, Jacob Lawrence, Gordon Parks, and other artists helped to illuminate the African American's perspective to the world. I, Jero, is an American painter. The paintings that I did for Black History Month was Michael Jackson, King of Pop, the 44th President, Barack Obama, and Morgan Freeman. Have a happy Black History Month, everybody.
Next, you will hear a poem that's probably make you very hungry, because when I read it, I was hungry. So you're going to hear a poem entitled Soul Food, and then you'll also hear a song entitled Listen.
Listen. Soul Food by me, Jedi Smith, and Napoleon Williams. When I think of soul food, it's just something about that Southern cooking that I just can't resist. The way that butter drips from that biscuit drips down my wrist. Oh yes, I gotta have a piece of that good old fried catfish. Lord have mercy on my soul. And a good old buttery off-road. As I have been told, as sure as the hair on my big afro, and a spray of oil sheen helps me to think of those good old collard greens. Oh, and those succulent baked beans. You know what I mean? And a side of ham hocks and green beans, or maybe even some ham or pinto beans. Soul food. There will be no stressing when I make that turkey and dressing. And macaroni. Sometimes at night, I dream of fried bologna. Now, I can't name nor explain every dish, but I can name a few that weren't in my previous list. Sweet potatoes, how delicious they are. And chicken when it's baked, grilled, and fried hard. Cabbage. Do I even have to say anything about it? And don't get me started on those sweet desserts. The Lord and I both know I don't need, but it is a part of my soul. Yep, it's a part of me. Banana pudding. Oh yes, it's not first, but it's close to best. I really do love that peach cobbler. Just thinking about it makes my mouth water. Oh, how time flies. I just can't help but to think of those flavorsome pies. I could go on for days naming different kinds there are. There's cherry, pecan, apple, key lime, and my personal favorite, sweet potato. Back in my day, my mother would whip up all kinds of treats. And let me tell you, pineapple upside down cake was indeed her specialty. Now, naming all these delectable foods that have been created throughout our history will take forever and a day. But me talking about it, it will never get you the full experience you need. So go out and get you some soul food.
Divine release. Oh, the time has come for my dreams to be heard. They will not be pushed aside or turned into your own, all because you won't listen. Listen, I am alone at a crossroad. I'm not at home in my own home. And I've tried and tried to say what's on my mind. You should have known. Oh, now I'm done believing you. You don't know what I'm feeling. More than what you made of me. I follow the voice you gave to me. But now I've got to find my own. There's someone here inside, someone I thought had died so long ago. Oh, I'm screaming out and my dreams will be heard. They faith will not be pushed aside and turned into your own, or cause you won't listen. Listen, I am alone at crossroads. I'm not at home in my own home. And I've tried and tried, say what's on my mind. You should have known, oh. Now I'm done believing you. You don't know what I'm feeling. I'm more than what you made of me. I follow the voice you gave to me. But now I've got to find my own. I don't know where I belong. But I've been moving on. If you don't, if you won't listen to the song here in my heart, a melody I start, and I will complete. Oh, now I'm done believing you. You don't know what I'm feeling. I'm more than what you made of me. I follow the voice you think you gave to me. But now I've got a mind of my own. My own.
A speech entitled Spreading the Good News Through Gospel Music. You will also be able to hear a gospel song entitled Amazing Grace, followed by a poem called The Fight.
Gospel music is a valuable part of African American heritage. Thomas A. Dorsey is the father of gospel music and has wrote many hymns such as Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
He wrote Take My Hand after the passing of his wife while on tour. He also wrote Precious Lord and Peace in the Valley, all of them being one of the many 3,000 songs that he penned during his spiritual awakening.
And now, American Grace.
Shining as everybody. My poem is called The Fight. The fight for the lives of my people will never stop. Every year, we are a movement, a hashtag, a statistic, and the summer threat. I'm waiting for the hashtag where they finally know that we matter. I'm waiting for the day that we can live in peace. I want to be known in America, but not because I was killed in my home. R.I.P. Breonna Taylor. I want them to know my name because I am a movement. Martin Luther King Jr. had a dream. The dream that came true, know his name. Rosa Parks, mother of the freedom movement, know her name. We know their names because we're in this too. It's time for everyone to know ours. So, what's your name? While you think upon that, here's mine. My name is Aisha, and I'm ready for change. Do something great today. Let everybody know your name.
Performances with a poem entitled How Long, followed by another poem entitled I Am the Black Child.
Okay, my poem is called How Long. August 28th, 1963, Martin Luther King gave his famous I Have a Dream speech in front of the Lincoln Memorial facing millions of people nationwide. How long will it take to make a justice for reality for all of God's children? How long will it be before we can live in a nation where we are able to be judged not by the color of our skin, but by the content of our character? How long will it be before we are able to work together, pray together, to struggle together, and to stand up for freedom together? How long before we don't hear about another George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Drayvon Reed, Rashard Brooks, Ahmaud Arbery, Tamir Rice, Eric Garner, and Quan Charles? In 1849, Harriet Tubman made the statement, I'm gonna be free or die. In 1947, Jackie Robinson asked a question, what are you afraid of, just so you can play baseball? All he wanted to do was hit the ball, yet his rival would not let him do so. But in the end, he did it. So after seeing all the stories of Martin Luther King, Harriet Tubman, and Jackie Robinson, I must ask the question, in 2021, how long before liberty and justice for all will be true? If America is to be a good nation for all of people, all of this must become true.
Here's to Life, followed by a poem by Dwayne.
Welcome to the Wolf Pride Radio. I'm your co-host, Jameson.
And I'm your co-host, Alex. How are you doing, Jameson?
I'm doing fine today. How about you?
I'm great. You know, I feel like listening to some blues.
Really? I feel like listening to some jazz myself.
Well, you know, they both have to do with soul.
Right, like Billie Holiday and Shirley Horns.
Yeah, all they sang blues and weren't saying jazz. Even if they sang different subgenres, they both still sang with soul.
Exactly, they both had class and passion.
With that being said, let's introduce Mr. Williams and Ms. Pett with Here's to Life by Shirley Horns. Yeah.
No complaints, no regrets. Still believe in chasing dreams and placing bets. But I have learned that all you give is all you get. So give it all you got. I've had my share, I drank my fill, and even though I'm satisfied, I'm hungry still to see what's down the road and beyond the hill and do it all again. So here's to love and every joy it brings. Yes, here's to love, to dreamers and their dreams. It's funny how life can go from warm hellos to sad goodbyes and leave you with the memories you have inside to keep your winters warm. But there's no yes in yesterday, and who knows what tomorrow brings or takes away. As long as I still in the game, I gotta play for laughs, for life, for love. So here's to love and every joy it brings. Yes, here's to life, to dreamers and their dreams. May all your storms be weathered, and all that's good gets better. Here's to life, here's to love, and here's to you. May all your storms be weathered, and all that's good gets better. Here's to life, here's to love, here's to you.
Well, to open up this poem, I want to propose a question. What happens when you put your thoughts into action? I mean, it's easy to think about thinking of something, but is it really as easy to act upon? Honestly, sometimes I find it difficult. Thinking of what needs to be done. At times I find myself lost in what feels like an endless sea of thought. An endless sea of thought. There are always a handful of ideas that may lend themselves to my usefulness. Though even once I found the actions worth carrying out, the object of motivation comes into play. So then, you might start thinking about what exactly motivates you. Whether it's a wealthier life or a better state of being. For me though, it's always a struggle. A struggle to find out what motivates me. When I was younger, it was to please my mother. Now that I'm getting older though, I find me using that excuse less and less. Truth is, it's getting harder to find that same motivation again. And as I look out at you all, I'm sure I'm not the only one who deals with this crux of motivation. But then again, how can we have that lack of motivation? How can we, descendants of warriors, proud leaders, civil activists, how can we feel that same lack of motivation? How can we not have thoughts of what needs to be done when there are injustices in our community? Well, that's a simple answer. We can't. We can no longer sit idly by and thought anymore. Whether it be school, life, work, we must hold that pride in our hearts, for that is our motivation. At least for me, it's the reason I've chosen to act, the reason I wrote this poem, and the reason I will continue to go on. So when you find yourself with that lack of motivation, completely devoid of thoughts, remember who you are, what you come from, royalty. Black royalty.
All right, we're heading to the end of our performances for today. Last up, we're going to have a performance called I Know Where I Have Been, followed by a dismissal with the Cupid Shuffle. Thank you for watching.
Black as my skin. There's a light burning bright, showing me the way. And I know where I'm going. There's a cry in the distance. There's a voice that comes from deep within. There's a cry asking why. The answer is a man. And I know when. There's a road we've been traveling. Lost so many along the way. And the riches will be plenty. Worth the price we have to pay. There's a dream in the future. There's a struggle that we have yet to win. the pride in the heart. Cause I know where I'm going, and I know where I've been. There's a road we must travel. Lost so many along the way, and the riches will be plenty. Worth the risk and the chances that we take. There's a dream in the future. There's a struggle that we have yet to win. Use the pride in the heart to lift the sun till tomorrow. Cause just to sit still would be a sin. And I know
all right, everybody. Come on, put your hands together.
This is something new. The Casting Slide Part 2. Featuring a platinum band. And this time, we're going to keep funky. Funky. Everybody clap your hands.
Thank you. Hope y'all have a good one. I got one more thing to say.